zu unserem zweiten Sprecher, Ken O'Keefe, irisch-amerikanischer Aktivist, obwohl seit immer im Jahre 2004 aus Protest gegen den US-Imperialismus seinen amerikanischen Pass verbrannt hat, könnte man ihn möglicherweise nur noch als Ire bezeichnen. Er diente als Marine im Zweiten Golfkrieg 1991 und sprach danach häufig über den Gebrauch von angereichertem Uran als Munition in dem Sinne eines Verbrechens gegen die Menschlichkeit. Bekannt geworden ist er auch durch die Aktion Menschliche Schutzschilde im Irak sowie einer der Teilnehmer der Hilfsexpedition nach Gaza, Dabari Marmara, wo er die Attacke der israelischen Sicherheitskräfte Gott sei Dank überlebte. Wir kommen zu unserem letzten Sprecher, Ken O'Keefe, dessen Vortrag sich mit den Grenzen der Diskussion praktische Lösungen für Selbstbestimmung in Palästina beschäftigen wird. Bitte sehr.
These are basic questions that any decent journalists or investigators would ask me. And here we are 10 years later, and I say to anyone out there who does not believe that this was an inside job, that Israel was involved, they're not responsible, let's be clear on this, they're not responsible, there is no way that 9/11 could have been carried out without 100% involvement from the treasonous elements within the United States government and military. There's simply no way. But security for the buildings, access to the buildings, the ability to take out Building 7, the farcical idea of a plane hitting the Pentagon, the non-existent air defenses, we can go on and on and on. This is the be-all and all of manipulation. Do you think it's not possible that those that have control of the nuclear weapons, that they couldn't set off a nuclear weapon? I've read some reports that a nuclear weapon might be set off in Zurich. Who knows? Or maybe London. How about Washington, D.C.? Is this not possible? Are we living in La La Land? Are we delusional? It's very possible. Now, what's going to happen if one of these weapons is set off? How are we going to respond? What are we going to do? Are we going to be manipulated yet again into the next farcical boogeyman enemy? Iran, perhaps? And what happens when that nuke goes off and then all of our prostitutes of propaganda, known as journalists in the mainstream media, tell us Iran is responsible for this? What happens then? Well, then that gives the justification now, doesn't it, for the Israelis, perhaps the Americans, to launch an attack on Iran. What's Iran going to do? Are they going to lay down? Or they're not, they're going to fight back. So what happens when they launch their missiles towards Tel Aviv? The Israelis are going to fire back. What are they going to fire back with? Nuclear weapons. What's going to happen then? This is the world we live in. Are we crazy? Are we collectively insane? I say that we are. I say that we are collectively insane. That we're not facing up to these facts. And if you're a parent, I'm a parent, I've got two children. The only reason why I'm doing this is because I care. I could create a little bubble for my children. Hell, I lived in Hawaii. I had a paradise life. I lived in paradise, had my own business, doing something I loved, with respecting the community. I left it. I actually fled America 2 months after 9/11, largely due to the fact that I knew it was an inside job, and I knew I can't keep my mouth shut, and I knew I was going to end up in prison for something that I didn't do. Just another in the largest prison population in the world claiming I've been set up. None of you would have even known who I am. You can't create a bubble. We all live on planet Earth. I don't care what country you live in. We are all brothers and sisters. That includes my Zionist, banking, imperialist, colonialist, psychopathic brothers and sisters. We are all brothers and sisters in one human family. And if we don't get this right, we are going to destroy this beautiful gift we've been given. How fucking stupid is that? I'm agreeing. How stupid is that? We are crazy. We must face the facts. Now, getting to Palestine, I was blessed to be able to spend 6 months in Gaza. And it's impossible to exaggerate the kind of suffering that is going on down there. I want you to imagine as a parent that you cannot protect your children. I want to imagine that your children, when they hear a jet flying overhead, or a helicopter flying overhead, or a drone flying overhead, are screaming, having nightmares, wetting themselves at night because they're terrified. You want to hear a story, horror story? Let's talk about the Sununi family. Let's talk about them. Operation Castlet, which was nothing more than one of the most obscene slaughters, not just in recent history, but ever. In virtually every conflict we can name, there's always refugees, but there were no refugees in this one. This was a captive population, 1.5, 1.6 million people. And if you go to Gaza, you're going to see something that I've seen, and that is an incredible amount of children all over the place. Over half of the population are children under the age of 15. There are children everywhere. And these people, these children, were bombarded for 22 days while our latest treasonous puppet, President Obama, said nothing, President-elect. not a damn thing, and then placated the Egyptian people just 6 months later, talking about Salaam Alaikum and bullshit pretenses to any kind of respect for the Muslim population and the Arab people, playing us all like a fool, as if this man was ever going to do anything. Why are we waiting for presidents and prime ministers in the UN to solve our problem? Are we stupid? Since when have any of these puppets or bodies done anything with regard to justice? So let's get back to the Samouni family. During Operation Cast Lead, the Samouni family, they come from a rural area. Most of the areas of Gaza are urban areas, but they live in a rural area. They're farmers. The Israelis took that area strategically and helped them split Gaza Strip into two. They took that area, they bulldozed many of the homes, they put their snipers up on top of the buildings that were left, and they told the Samouni family, which is well over 250 members of the family, many of them have managed to get out of that area as a tomb, but of the approximately 100 that were left, 97 were told to go into one of the homes, Wael Samouni, into his home. 97. Imagine just a small portion, or maybe that post over there, this way, maybe 10 meters to there, a square area like that. 97. I don't know how many people are in this room right now. Probably less. So imagine all of you packed into a space over there. Now imagine it's winter time. Imagine that you are sitting in there with your children, your grandchildren, your uncles, your aunts, your brothers, your sisters. And within 24 hours of the Israelis ordering 97 members of the Samouni family into that space, they hit it with rockets. Now I want you to imagine you're in the winter, middle of winter, it's cold, you've got no electricity, it's dark because they hit it at night, and now what you've got is 29 members of your family that are dead, body parts strewn all over the place, you've got others who are seriously injured, who are bleeding to death. You've got children lying next to the corpses of their parents. Parents lying next to the corpses of their children. And then imagine that you're stuck there for 4.5 fucking days. 4.5 days. Not allowed to get any medical attention. Deprived of any opportunity. Imagine yourself as Zeinat Samouni, whose husband was shot dead in front of the family. Imagine yourself also as a mother, while your 4-year-old son, Ahmed, was shot twice in the chest and then died over 1.5 days. Just one of the few that was not allowed to get medical attention. Now imagine that you've been through all this stuff, and yet, a guy like me who comes from America, I mean, that's all they know. I mean, most people in Gaza don't know who I am. But you can, from my accent, from my appearance, surmise that I'm obviously not from Gaza, and probably pretty quickly understand that I'm from America, actually. I want you to imagine that a guy like me can walk the streets of Gaza, free as I did for 6 months, and anywhere I went, I was treated with love and respect and hospitality. Through all of this injustice, the people of Palestine have not lost their humanity. And this is the most incredible thing. Because I don't believe that the American people at all, had they been subjected to this type of behavior, would have even an ounce of humanity in them, the vast majority of them. We would be a bloodthirsty lot that would, no hesitation, torture our own collaborators and slaughter anyone who even thought to come from that land that had been persecuting us and oppressing us. And yet the Palestinians remain dignified, hospitable, generous. They're better than most of us, I can tell you. How can you not become enriched, blessed, and strengthened to experience such people? The Palestinian people are not just my friends, they are my family. And ultimately, any one of us who's serious about helping the Palestinian people, working with them, can expect the same types of things that Gilad and myself and many others experience. I myself believe in direct action. Talk is cheap. We can keep talking till the end of time, but when are we going to do something meaningful? Is it possible that maybe we might risk our lives because we believe in something beyond ourselves? Well, that's exactly what happened with Ahmadi Marmar. And I tell you what, I've been playing this direct action game with Western circles, and it is a circus. It is a circus. Disgusting game with so many egos, so much politics, so much crap. And with friends like these, God help the Palestinians, because we play so many damn games. But being on the Mali Marmara with the Turkish was beautiful. Despite the carnage, the executions, the blood, it was an honor to stand side by side with the Turks. I love them, they're fighters. And when we had an opportunity to kill the same murderers that were executing us, we let them go. We could have killed them. I could have killed them personally. I had one of their weapons. Could have done it. But I'm not a killer. I don't want to kill. I will defend myself. If one of them had been coming towards me and was getting ready to fire, make no mistake about it, I would have taken him out if I had a chance before he got me. Because I care about Palestine and I'm prepared to die for Palestine and I have a certain level of intelligence, I'm a target of Israel, and I will be for the rest of my life. There are most powerful elements in this bullshit system of tyrannical rule, including Mossad and the CIA and all these other James Bond wannabe wankers that run around thinking they're doing something beneficial for humanity or their nation or whatever it is. They're fooling themselves and deluding themselves into believing. These people are nothing more than agents of a psychopath system of tyrants. And if one of them gets me, Soviet. But you know what? In the good old days, they would have just executed me. They would have just got rid of me. But the best tactic these days is slander. And myself, that's what I enjoy as a result of my commitment to the Palestinian cause. If you believe some, I'm a thief. I'm using the Palestinian cause so I can get up here on a platform and impress you all with my ability to articulate. I am intoxicated by the camera. Boy, oh boy, doesn't it make me feel so great that I'm on BBC and CNN and all this stuff. Actually, what people are doing is reflecting themselves upon me, because I guess, apparently, this gives meaning to people's lives. Otherwise, unsatisfied, unfulfilled, seeking all the wrong things to find that elusive happiness and spiritual awareness through things like being on the television. I am not so intoxicated by things like that. Probably part of the reason why I can get up in front of an audience and actually connect with people. Because you may not like everything that I say, but I'm damn well sincere. And I mean what I say. So if you believe some of those that are working for the other side, posing as Palestinian solidarity activists, I'm a thief. I'm a womanizer. I like to lure young women into my apartment in Gaza. I've nearly been arrested twice by Hamas. I think Hamas are stupid, and Hamas think I'm a freak. I'm a Nazi, by the way, and I'm also a white supremacist with my Palestinian wife and Palestinian children. And all of this is nothing more than cover because I just want to profit off of the Palestinian cause. This is a new form of assassination, and this is what you will get to enjoy if you really want to take a frontline role in helping the Palestinian people. And in particular, in this case, my connection with the Samouni family is what really is getting me this attention. And I think, how much time do I have left? Or am I beyond my time?
4 minutes.
Okay. As I said, I believe in direct action. So what do we do? Now we know the problem, what the hell do you do? Let me just say, aid is not the answer. In fact, aid is very much part of the problem. Aid is something that we do normally in the aftermath of an actual disaster, when people need to have things brought in to be able to survive. What we have in Gaza is not a natural disaster, it's a man-made disaster, a human-made disaster. It's a disaster that's allowed to continue because of our complicity, our apathy, our ineffectiveness. That's why it exists. And it will continue to exist as long as we run around in our little circus pretending as if our demonstrations and all these other things that we're doing are actually going to have the ultimate effect. You have to be just a little bit more intelligent than that, a little bit more serious. Check the ego at the door, and all of this infighting and solidarity campaign, solidarity movement, this stuff has got to go. It really has to go. Aid is not the answer. Israel controls the aid industry. Israel makes ungodly amounts of money on all this aid going through. Aid takes a people And what it does, it relegates them to an existence where, remember, let's think again as a parent. You cannot protect your children. You can't. No matter how much you may wish to, you cannot protect your children. So this is the one reality for the parents in Gaza. Two, you can't even provide for your family. 80% of the people in Gaza, if not more, are reliant upon aid to survive. So you can't protect your family. You can't provide for your family. What do you think that does to the children? How do you think the children feel about their parents when they realize that they cannot protect or provide for them? So you go like a beggar, because you have no choice, to the UN, and to the aid industry, and to the aid agencies, and you collect your food, and you take it back home to your family, and that's your life. And you know what? The Israelis know it. They love it. They love it. They love creating this environment of undignified existence. They know that it's harming the fabric of the society. And they relish it. And we play right into it with aid. Aid is not the answer. There are many things we can do, but the one thing that must happen, because the Palestinian people do not wish to live on aid, it's an insult that we think that that's the best way to help them. The Palestinian people are amongst the most educated, resourceful, intelligent, hospitable, moral people you would ever want to meet, and they don't want to live on handouts. If they had access to markets abroad, just like every other country has to have, if they had access to the resources, they would rebuild those factories that have been destroyed. They would rebuild their homes that have been destroyed. They would regenerate their economy by starting up their businesses or reviving their businesses. They would create their own jobs, and they would be self-sufficient, and they would live a dignified life. Hell, they could be the leader in things like, for instance, alternative energy. Here's a great place for that. I would like to get with any of you who know any people who are serious about alternative energy technologies and things like that. I want to take things like that down to Gaza. I don't want to take shoes and clothes and food. I have no interest in that. I want to bring raw materials. I want to bring beehives, because the honey industry was destroyed. I want to bring beehives so they can revive the honey industry. I want to bring a loom that the Samouni family could use to produce Palestinian scarves, kufiyas. Would you buy a Palestinian scarf made in Gaza by the Samouni family, and would you pay extra for something like that? Let's get a loom down to Gaza. Why not? I want to bring industrial dehydrators down to Gaza, because the Samouni family are farmers, and they have all the food necessary to put into these dehydrators, dehydrate that food, and let's export it out, because they have all the ability. There's so many different things that we could bring down to Gaza that could revive the economy so that the Palestinian people could stand on their own 2 feet. Those are the things I want to bring down to Gaza. And if you're serious and you really want to help make this happen, we can do it. Believe me, we can do it. No excuses. There's so much talent, so much ingenuity, so much capability, so much potential just in this room. Never mind in the whole so-called movement. Let's get real. Let's get serious. Let's do something beautiful. I tell you what, in part, I believe, when I first got involved in Palestine, the reason why, actually before that, I got involved in human rights. My first love was the sea. My first real passion was protecting the sea. And I did a hell of a job doing it, and was ultimately blessed. But eventually I realized, through my involvement in the Hawaiian independence movement, that human rights is the key. If we don't get this, if we can't comprehend, as it says, ironically, in the first line of the Universal Declaration, it says it all. How ironic, since I despise the UN. Whereas recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation for freedom, justice, and peace in our world. Exactly. When every single person on this planet is able to live a dignified life, when every single person on this planet has their human rights respected, then that is the day that I look forward to living in peace. But I don't have any interest in peace without those things. In fact, I'm not occupied or preoccupied with peace at all. I'm much more focused on truth, and in particular, justice. Not vengeance, justice. And if the criminals and the psychopaths were afforded, say, perhaps 1 year amnesty to come clean, I would be willing, for one, to say, okay, The people can decide. Because I don't have any interest in vengeance. Justice is what we need in this world. Forget peace right now. I got involved in Palestine because I came to the conclusion that Palestine is the key. This is before I had any kind of emotional, sort of involvement. I saw this is the problem. This is the problem. If we don't solve this problem, we're not going to solve our overall problem. This is the one. And since that time, I've become emotionally involved. And I love the people of Palestine. They are my family. I was given a Palestinian passport, but it's more than a piece of paper. When I was taken on Mali Marmara, I got rid of my Irish passport. And when we were taken to Ashdod, I handed them Assad and the Shin Bet, I handed them my Palestinian passport. If you want to deport me, then deport me to Palestine. That's how I feel about it. I was born in America, but I have no connection to America. I have no animosity or hatred for the ignorance of the American people. I wish them the best, but I have no connection to the US government, no love for that government. I am not a US citizen. We all have a human right to self-determination. We all determine who we are. You determine your religion. You determine your political status. I am a Palestinian. I am also a Hawaiian. I'm an Irishman as well. But more than anything else, I'm a world citizen. And I believe being human requires you to be a world citizen. My allegiance is to my entire human family, including my Zionist brothers and sisters. But my Zionist and psychopath brothers and sisters are a threat to all of us. And as you act like that, then you should be dealt with accordingly. And if you can't understand the concept of one love, one humanity, one future, if that's beyond you, then we got to deal with you. And I believe that we are on the verge of two possibilities. One, we don't get it, we're one false flag operation away from the Third World War, nuclear Armageddon. Two, we hit that point of critical mass, we get smart, we get human, and we change this world for the better. And we hand over this world in a better state than we got it. And we honor ourselves and our children and our grandchildren and all the future generations by becoming sane and doing something right. I believe it's up to us. Forget everyone else, it's up to us, people like us in this room. Thank you.